Brett found exact and formal field theory, which represents the test phrase. And one can also, they're presumably exactly quotable, though no one's done so yet. And one can also talk about a half an F test phrase solution, which is related to a boundary Louisville theory. And I'm just trying to understand what happens on the test phrase in open space spectrum is another interesting exercise. And some concrete calculation in open string theory. And what I've done is to compute the particle production of open string modes on a decaying S-brain. And, okay, so what happens is that as the S-brain decays, and in fact, it sort of tries to prevent at a temperature higher than the Hagedorn temperature. And I believe that the brain dumps all of its energy into, first of all, into open string particle production, which then comes to closed string. I believe that the brain dumps all of its energy into closed string at a time of order J to 0. And it struck me as I was listening to Eva's talk that that might be the this might be a very interesting bilocal shift. This might be a very interesting place to apply those ideas and get the outgoing open string activity. So what's the best of all possible worlds in this discussion? Well, the best of all possible worlds is that we can understand some time-dependent open string theories, take their large and limit, and say that they're holographically dual to some time-dependent closed string cosmology. And the worst of all possible worlds is that we just continue to thrash around and learn some more things about time-dependent open string theory. And, am I right? I'm very sorry. My conclusion then is that understanding the nature of time and string theory is a challenging and exciting problem. There are lots of concrete things to work on, but there's also a big reward out there that we may be able to understand some of these really interesting conceptual questions.
Right now. When are we allowed to stop? I prefer not
Fury Spin. Thanks, the organizers for inviting me. It's, what am I doing? Oh, you're doing it. It's not natural. You're not inviting me now. It's wonderful to be in Cambridge for the first time for you as well, so thank you. I'm going to talk about some work, basically reviewing some things I've been thinking about for the past year or so. And the primary motivation for thinking about this was to, was the following very simple basic observation that, at least from the point of view of model building, we've been using higher dimensions for a while now to do interesting things, those extensions in the standard model. And there are two ingredients that they offer that make them interesting. One of them is that you get more bigger local symmetries, higher dimensional local symmetries. So you get higher dimensional gauge symmetries or higher dimensional Galois invariants. And the other one is that locality in the extra dimension serves as a tool to suppress unwanted interactions in your theory. If you have fields that are localized at opposite ends of the world, for example, then unknown short distance physics can't give arbitrarily large contact interactions between them. They have to be exponentially suppressed by some by the fundamental map scale times the distance between them, and that's a useful thing. And a simple observation is that neither one of these things have anything to do with extra dimensions that can in fact be obtained in completely four-dimensional theories, which actually generalize in interesting ways both the idea of higher dimensional gauge and the locality in ways that are often more fruitful. And so the sort of what exemplifies in a very simple way is to imagine that you have a four-dimensional fiber or loose model. And so you just have a whole bunch of gauge sectors, and they're connected by fields which transform into a simple example like Feynman intervals under all the gauge groups. Now let's see how this how these two ingredients manifest. They manifest themselves in very obvious ways. Obviously, there's a big gauge symmetry. There's those many gauge groups. And locality is also obvious in this picture. For example, let's say I take this this chain and I choose to shut off one of the gauge couplings. Let's say that one. Then what happens is the chain just falls apart into two different chains that cannot possibly interact with each other. The only interaction came through that gauge couple.